Thank you. You know what, folks? Can I ask you just to stand up for a moment as you're able? And we're just going to take 30 seconds to come back home to the sense of being in your body. So you can put your hand over the lower abdomen, or you put over your hand over your heart, whatever feels good there, and simply bring the attention back home to your body. Because as we do this, we're bringing our consciousness, we're bringing our energy back into the body. So just the sense of curiosity, what does that feel like right now? Yeah, peaceful, very nice. And four slow breaths into the lower abdomen. And just be very curious. Very nice. Very nice indeed. Thank you so much, folks. You can have a sit again. Really appreciate that. So you're going to find that this is going to be very interactive, very participatory, because it's 1:30 right now, and we can be kind of waning in energy. First of all, I just want to thank you. Thank you for being here, but I also just want to honor you. The fact that you folks showed up today sends a very powerful message about getting better, getting stronger, healing, wholeness. So right from the kind of level of, you call it psyche or even spirit, saying to your body, I want to get better, I want to understand the medical system. And so just hats off for you just showing up today, getting the best information from the medical system, and then empowering yourself, which I'm hoping to add to body, mind, and spirit. And it's that combination of the two, the medical system plus what you can do to empower yourself, that gives you the best chances. And so just listening to this, I think, is really a huge, huge step forward. I also just want to say I'm excited because this is about my 25th year of giving public talks. And in those first decade or so, I didn't have a whole bunch to say other than what's obvious, what you guys know already, kind of the mind profoundly influences the body, and you can make a terrific difference in your health and your happiness. It's just so obvious. But I'm excited because the science, the brain science, the neuropsychoimmunology science actually shows that you can have a profound influence. And I'm thinking about WM, and I'm thinking about, well, the uncertainties, what's going to happen in the future, and kind of the stresses around that, and the influence on the immune function. And one of the major side effects of the chemotherapies is to suppress immune function. So I want to think about it from a very practical perspective. How can you maintain your body? How can you maintain that kind of system, your immunology, to be able to fight infections? How can you give yourself the best chance? And that's what I want to give you, very, very practical advice around that. So that's why I'm excited around this. But I also just want to always take a big step back and say, well, what's the goal? What are the goals in your life? You know, you get a blood disorder, you get something that brings this uncertainty within your life. And so what do you want? Really, what do you want? And I'm going to suggest it to you. I mean, what's the obvious thing that you want? Get a diagnosis, what do you want? Yeah, cure. I mean, it's not quite there yet, is my impression. But then what's the next thing around cure? Whether we just had a fantastic example of? You want longevity, right? You want to live for a decade, two decades, three decades. Really is the hope and the inspiration. What else do you want? What else are your goals? Say again? Yeah, so you want to empower yourself and feel better, because that's so important. That's part of what I see as the kind of medical system part of this, is putting yourself in the driver's seat or the control tower at the airport, right? When you're looking down and seeing those planes taking off, it's a much different experience than being in the back of the plane, right? So this, it's so important why you showed up today and why that's powerful. What do we humans want generally?
Quality of life,
yeah. We want to feel more settled. We want to feel more grounded, more peaceful. Like the descriptions that you guys are providing. How do we maximize our quality of life? So that's really important. And related to that, and I didn't understand this until about 5 years ago, we're getting older, and so what else do we want? You want to be able to think more clearly, right? You want to have better brain function. You want to be able to function and do the things that you want to do. So those are all the things that I'm going to try to point towards. And also, I'm trying to point you towards this idea of finding meaning. Like, why do you want to be alive 20 years from now? So if you want to see your grandkids, you know, get married or get a job or those type of things, it's really important to have those greater purposes, which will give you motivation to do the things that I'm about to explain to you. So looking for those purposes, longevity, improvements in quality of life, or I call it happiness, or and function, brain function, and so on. And you can profoundly influence your health at those levels. I really believe that's true. And so I'm going to offer you some of the science and the practice, the practicality of how to get there, what you need to do in the day-to-day. Okay, so purpose. Now, I've talked about meaning a little bit, but I also want to talk about something called setting the intention, which to me means remembering what's most important to you, right? What's your kind of purpose for the day? Or the other question is, how do you want to be in this world? Because there is a conscious choice there. And the brain science shows that whatever you practice, you get better at. It's essentially as good as that. So if you're in a kind of more flustered and agitated state, your brain will get very good at setting down the pathways of being nervous and stressed and feeling overwhelmed. And if you practice being more centered, calm, clear thinking, confident, whatever those attributes that you want to be in this world, if you practice that, the brain circuitry follows a suit. And so either this happens to you naturally without you being conscious of it, or you can actually become conscious and kind of reverse engineer your brain. Your brain is the only organ that continues to change itself within its body. So it's really malleable. No matter what age you're at, you continue to actually put down new neurons, which you didn't understand until, you know, several years ago, and new pathways. So your brain is sculpting according to your experience. And what I'm suggesting to you is to plan your experience, plan how you want to be in the world. Consciously do that. So it's something I call setting the intention, and I see it in two contexts. One is at the start of the day, saying to yourself, you know, this is how I want to be, this is how I want to practice, these are the values that I have that I want to have when I interact with people. Right? So it's kind of like setting yourself up subconsciously as to how you want to be. And then the second thing is being able to identify as early as possible in the situations when you're getting blown off course, when you're getting really flustered or upset or angry, and you're thinking to yourself, I don't need to go there. I can actually come back home to that sense of centeredness and calm and peace and so on. So those are two situations, right? First, setting the intention of the day, and then, you know, going into a difficult situation or going into your doctor's office. Like, okay, tell me, how do you guys want to be? When you're about to go in to see your hematologist, walking in that room and the conversation's about to start, describe your state of mind that you'd like to be in at that point. Calm. What else? Clear thinking, right? Confident. You may even think, I need to advocate for myself. I need to step up and be able to be clear-minded enough to do this, right? So that's a situation where most people are nervous going in, but you can actually decide to practice to be more clear thinking, more centered, and better able to interact with your physician at that point. Or any other difficult situation, you know, dealing with a difficult family member or family situation or a job situation, you can always plan going into it. And also when you're in the midst of it and you feel yourself getting too overwhelmed, we can settle yourself down. And I'm going to give you some particular kind of techniques around that. So all to say, I want to actually do that little bit of setting the intention with you, and I'm going to describe some of the neuroscience afterwards as to why this might work. So if you would, we're going to do a little bit of relaxation, a little bit of visualization, very safe and easy, participate in the way that feels good for you. But I want you to pull yourself off the back of the chair if that's what feels right, so you're not leaning anymore. And assume the what I would see as a dignified or noble posture, what I call body up, right? Your body's in a certain posture, like I have strength and peace and solidity, and I'm taking my seat, and that sends a signal to your brain. So I'll take you through just a couple minutes of mindfulness and then just a visualization. So, okay, so again, you're gonna create that sense of curiosity. What does it feel like to be in your body right now? What are the sensations? So without labeling or thinking about it, just experience it. So bring your attention to your feet. Sense of feeling grounded to the floor. Bring your attention now to your hands, the weight of the hands and the knees, sense of energy. Bring your attention to your backbone. What does that feel like? Bring your attention now to the front of your chest. And what does that feel like? Sense of warmth or rawness. And that's our humanness. We have that strong, solid spine or solidity, and we also have a warm, open heart. Bring your attention now to your breathing. And again, just a sense of curiosity. What are the sensations of breathing? Now the visualization begins. Imagine that you're breathing in a sense of calm and peace. So you're breathing that in on the in-breath, and then on the out-breath, you simply release and relax. So breathing in calm and peace, out-breath, release, relax, let go. And continue to breathe at whatever rate's best for you. You're inviting in that kind of universal calm, universal kind of loving energy into your being. And out-breath, simply drain away any sense of tension, stress. Coming back home to just the experience of breathing in, breathing out, calm and relaxing. Now I want to bring your attention to the level of the heart. So here, imagine that you're warming up your heart with a sense of compassion, a sense of caring. So bringing the conscious energy to the level of heart, allowing the heart to warm like the element on a stove. Now to warm that up with a real sense of compassion, bring to mind somebody that you dearly love, or your pet, or maybe at a different time in your life, maybe when your kids were young, or maybe when you were a child and really connected with somebody like your grandmother or somebody very close, a parent. Allow your heart to warm again. And you hear the sounds of the world outside, and that's okay. Just bring your attention back to your heart. Yeah, just allow that. Bring to mind somebody in your life who's suffering in some way or form. So that could be somebody very close to you. Could be somebody at a distance that you know. Allow your heart to warm. It's like you're sending them a sense of prayer or loving energy, wishing them well, wishing them healing on their journey. And again, your heart's warming, maybe like the sunlight coming over the horizon, a beam of light in the middle of your chest. And bring to mind now your friends and your family members, all the people that you love. And as those images come to mind, as these people come to mind, just allow your heart again to warm and send each one of them that sense of peace and calm, right from your heart to their hearts. Sense of radiance from the middle of your chest now, that warm, universal, limitless energy of healing, golden energy is radiating everywhere outwards. Now imagine you're sending that out to everybody here in the room, everybody in the Wally team. Sending it out, everybody here, let them find healing in whatever way is best for them, body, mind, or spirit. And extend that out to everybody anywhere in this world who's affected by WM. Really wish them well on their journey and all their loved ones around them. And again, from that universal space, send that healing energy to everybody everywhere in the world, regardless of diagnosis, anybody who's suffering. And you may notice that that universal energy of your own healing, kindness, and compassion is radiating in every direction, washing over your tissues, energizing you, helping to heal levels of body, mind, and spirit. You don't even have to do anything. It's always there. And from that space, set an intention for yourself. What is it that you need to learn? How is it that you need to grow? How do you want to be in this world? How do you want to bring your spirit into this world? Connection with others and in life itself. So set that intention and let it be so. Bring your attention now back to the meditative state. You can open your eyes, but keep your meditative state. Allow yourself to ground with the floor, the sense of connection of feet to the floor. Next out-breath, allow your mind to expand into the space. And realize that your good human heart connects the two. That sense of connection with the earth, our solidity, our physicality. That sense of connection with the above. Sense of healing, possibility, wholeness, and that your good human heart connects the two. And I'll just chime to finish then. Thank you very much. That's wonderful, folks. I really appreciate the spending of the time. The energy that we generate actually as a group. And the power of the support group as well, right? You really can connect with people. And we have something called mirror neurons. So when we're in a good space, we're actually, people around us pick up that kind of sense of energy. So we have a capacity, no matter what condition we're in, we have that capacity to connect with that next person who walks in the room and to brighten their day in some way or form. It's always there. The opportunity is always there. So I took you through maybe a 3 or 4 minute exercise, and there would have actually been some physiological changes in your brain. So your brain would have changed. The way your brain thought, you'd be thinking more out of your frontal lobe, the compassionate, wise part of your brain. Your heart rate would have dropped, your blood pressure would have dropped, there'd be more relaxation within your body, the tension in the muscles. You would have had a relaxation response. And there's something called heart rate variability, which I'll explain in a second, but also the heart actually has an electromagnetic field around it. Your field would have changed, and that field influences other people as well. It's the how we have an energy and we connect with people. So the science is there, very, very clear science around that. And I'm excited because I've been reading about this idea of heart rate variability, which essentially means that your heart rate, maybe you're beating along at 75 beats per minute, but you're not exactly at 75. You actually fluctuate maybe 74.5 and then you're at 75.5. You know, it kind of goes back and forth. And the more you kind of vary, the healthier your heart is. The more kind of up and down within the narrow range, the more relaxed and the healthier, the better it is that your body's able to heal, to kind of rest and digest. You've heard of fight and flight. When you're in that more positive and more relaxed state, you have a higher heart rate variability. And you can actually train that. You can actually change the physiology in your body. And it's through a breathing technique that I will teach you later on in this talk. So the 4 slow breaths. But what I learned recently is that as if you could also bring to mind some positive experience or some feeling of compassion or something that makes you happy, So if you can remember like petting your dog at home, is that the feeling that makes you happy? As you do the four slow breaths, you visualize that, you put your energy into the heart level, and you actually increase your heart rate variability, and it actually allows your body to heal itself more easily. So the science is clear, you can teach yourself this technique, and as you practice that technique, you get better and better, and in the midst of the flustered days, you can bring yourself back home again through these type of relaxation exercises. So I took you through whatever, 3-4 minutes of a relaxation exercise, and you really did change your physiology and how your brain works. And I'm just gonna take off my jacket here because I'm starting to sweat. I'm starting to get excited about explaining this to you. Okay, so I want to talk to you about the brain, because the idea is you're in two states of mind. You're in either one of two states of mind at any point in time. You're either in your irritable stress brain, your flustered brain, or you're in your wise and compassionate brain. Your brain function goes between the two, and hopefully at the end of that relaxation exercise, you're back into the compassionate and wise brain and thinking from there. And there's a real advantage to that. The outside world is going to offer you the same challenges, right? You're still going to be going to your physician visit. You're still going to be doing whichever treatments or not. And whatever's going to happen, people are going to still behave in the same way. But when you're in your wise and compassionate brain, you're better able to think about the options, think about how you want to respond, as opposed to being kind of a victim to the circumstance. It's a much more empowering state to be. So you flip back and forth throughout the day between the stressed brain and the wise and compassionate brain is really the takeaway. And to show that as a hand model, so the wrist would be the spine, and then through evolution, the first level of neurological function was the base of the thumb, which is the reptilian brain. That's the fight or flight, the automatic nervous system, which gets you out of danger automatically. So that's reptilian. And then the next level of the nervous system that grew over evolution is the limbic brain or the emotional brain, which I call the stress and irritable brain. It's more of an approach seeking system, looking for essentially sex or food is what that kind of set up to be. And then our very human brain grew kind of over top of it. And that's the wise and compassionate brain, very much associated with social, takes a village to raise a child, ethics, morality, and just much more complex thinking happens there. And we want to stay here because you're happier and you're healthier, which I think is really the kind of big goal here, happier and healthier when you live out of that part of your brain. And the idea is not to kind of flip your lid, not to kind of lose it and stay there. We want to come back home to the default state, which is that kind of centered, positive, clear thinking state of mind. So how do we do that? So this is where the kind of body, mind, spirit connection comes into it, is that our bodies actually have an influence on our brains. It's not just my thoughts influence my body, it's like one system. One system, because for instance, the bowel has millions and millions of neurons or nerve cells around it that's connected directly to your brain. Even your heart has about 40,000 neurons or nerve cells around it. Again, that's directly connected to your brain. So the takeaway is it's important to take care of your gut. Be kind to your gut. Because when you eat that McDonald's hamburger, your gut can kind of get twisted a little bit, and then your gut doesn't feel good and your brain doesn't feel good. So it's what I call body up. In fact, okay, so I know that we're slowing down here. Let's actually, everyone stand up, and I want you to assume the power pose. So you know Wonder Woman? So hands on the hip, chest a little bit high, kind of looking up. It was a Wonder Woman movie from like a year ago, something like that. So just take up a little bit of space. Now supposedly when you assume this posture, and there's some debate in the literature, it actually increases the testosterone levels within your brain and decreases the cortisol levels. And so you're more confident and you feel better and feel stronger. And you have to maintain this for about a minute and a half. And I'll tell you the quick story around this. So I wasn't sure about this idea, and I was being interviewed for World Cancer Day. And, you know, so I'm on CTV, Atlantic Live at 5 and all that stuff. I'm typically very nervous going into these interviews. And like, what is the person going to ask me? How am I going to look? You know, the usual kind of psychological stuff. But I decided to do the power pose in the wings of the studio. And it actually felt better. I felt like stronger. And so when I was in the interview, I felt like I was sitting up higher. I was looking the interviewer right in the eyes. I was really listening to the questions and then really concentrating on how I wanted to respond. So I really felt like I gave a better interview by doing the power pose. So it's an option for you coming into your the cancer center. So you can have a sit again, folks. Yeah. Right? So you can wait in your room and stand up a little bit and kind of give yourself some strength. I'm not so sure it works in a waiting room type scenario, so.
Worth a try.
Yeah, worth a try. Just give it, yeah, give it a try.
I've heard that called
Superman
pose.
Superman pose, right? Wonder Woman, Superman. Okay, so that's an idea of a body up situation. How about another body up? What do you do at 3 a.m. And suddenly you got insomnia and you got this chattering mind and you're trying to figure out what are you going to do for the next 5 years? Tomorrow? So what do you guys do at 3 a.m.?
Watch TV.
Read a book.
Walk around.
Okay, so we're going to talk about sleep hygiene. This is an important topic, actually. I actually practice a relaxation technique, right? Because it's the chattering mind that's driving the stress that's keeping you awake, essentially, right? So we have bad sleep for lots of different reasons. But I actually practice a relaxation technique. Let go of the chattering mind, bring my attention into my body, breathing in, breathing out, watching my breathing. And yes, it doesn't work perfectly, but when the body relaxes, the mind is much, it's much easier for the mind to relax and go to sleep. And I actually had some insomnia last night, and typically what I do is I just wait. I put in the 2 hours of boredom and eventually I go back to sleep again. And we'll talk about why it's better to stay in the dark shortly. But that's another example of body up. When the body is relaxed, the mind can be more relaxed. Okay, so what are some of the health habits that promote your brain functioning better? So we're just talking about brain. Forget about quality of life, which is super important, and energy, just brain function. What's number one? So sleeping, okay, so we'll talk about sleep then, agreed. So right, when we're sleep deprived, it's really hard to think clearly, right? And we're more irritable when we're tired. In fact, we don't metabolize the glucose in our system as well. In fact, we eat more without being conscious of it when we're sleep deprived, right? So what do you guys do to improve the quality of your sleep? Right? You can't force yourself to sleep, but you can set up the circumstances in which you're more likely to sleep. So routine, right? So getting to bed at the same time, getting the lights darker.
Yeah, I have a blackout curtain.
Yes. Yeah, because any bright light, so even 90 seconds of bright light in the middle of the night suppresses melatonin and the other healthy hormones that are released during a good night's sleep. And so that's why I suggest not turning on the lights in the middle of the night. Instead, do the blind person's routine, walk to the bathroom, right? So what are some of the things you want to avoid?
Electronics.
Yes, so turn off the screens, all of the screens, because there's that blue light that's coming in your eyes and jarring your system.
Caffeine.
The caffeine, the exercise, the big meals, whatever's going to jar you. Don't watch the horror films. You know, we want to kind of allow the body to settle down throughout the night. Yeah, so... Okay, so sleep is very important. You want to catch up. Napping good or bad?
Good.
Good, yeah. It's actually some good data. I mean, there are conditions. There's some good data to show that if you nap during the day, like as a single nap during the day, you get a better quality sleep that night, and you wake up more refreshed the next morning, right? But not too long, so 15, 20 minutes, and before 5 p.m., right? So there are certain things you can do to help your sleep. So sleep, I think I agree with you, is probably number one in terms of being clear thinking and happier, healthier. Post-napping actually changes the chemistry of your brain and able to learn different types of things. Okay, so sleep is number one in my books. What's the next healthy habit that really influences brain function? Exercise, yeah. So there's, you know, I'm hearing lots of good suggestions there. But let's talk exercise. Exercise, super, super important. When you exercise, you actually release these chemicals in the brain called brain-derived growth factor, which set you up to learn more. You actually put down new pathways when you exercise. There was an Australian study of essentially couch potatoes that they gave a gym membership to. And these guys were going to the gym like 3 times a week. And after, it was like 3 months, they had done the MRI scans of their brains before and afterwards. They actually showed thickening in the left frontal lobe, in the same wise and compassionate part of the brain. Right? So exercise by itself promotes brain function in a good sense. It increases your energy. It's super important in terms of energy. So even, it's paradoxical, I'm too tired to exercise, it's just the opposite. Just the slowly increasing your exercise over the week will give you more energy, better quality of sleep, better quality of life.
Within limits, I suppose.
Yes, within limits, right? Because we have to listen to our bodies in terms of what we can do. But we're talking, even people within the, you know, 2 months of the end of their life, they've done studies to show that they have better strength getting out of the bed, better grip strength. They actually improve their quality of life by even doing simple things like walking across the room and so on. So at any point within your journey, you can, if you can slowly increase your exercise over the weeks and months, you will get stronger. Your body will adapt.
But if you are getting tired, if you get tired from your exercise,
right,
that might not.
Yeah, so we don't want to exhaust ourselves. And I would always say to you, talk to an expert to modify your plan. Can everybody stand up again? So how much exercise do you need? How much, what's the recommended amount?
Minimum of 150 minutes.
150 minutes a week, which is about 30 minutes a day most days. How hard? What does moderate mean?
A little out of breath. Just,
exactly, like I can complete a single sentence, but I can't sing completely. It's not like one word, slight sweat in the brow. Okay, to the degree that you're able, please don't hurt yourself, I want you to do some squats on the spot. So just even tiny squats would be fine. What is the new recommendation in terms of exercise? 150 minutes. What are we adding to those within those 150 minutes? You're kind of doing it right now, I'm setting. Yeah. Good. You guys gotta have a sit? It's just fine, thank you. It's exactly just warming up. It's strength training. So twice per week within that is actually to do strength training. It's 8 to 10 muscle groups. So we just did squats, right, which is quads and glutes. So those are two groups. 8 to 10 muscle groups, 8 to 10 reps, 2 sets. So is that kind of 30 minutes as well? I think it also increases the kind of intracranial pressure, the pressure in the brain that kind of flushes the metabolites and other toxins out of your brain by kind of increasing the pressure there. So it's another reason. But you'll improve your function by adding a little bit of extra strength beyond the kind of aerobic stuff that I'm talking about. Okay, so how do you guys do it? Like, what are some of the tricks of the trade to actually make sure you actually get your exercise?
Take the stairs.
So you kind of integrate, instead of kind of taking the elevator, what the heck, I can do that floor. So you integrate that within your day, or, you know, walk to work or walk to your friend's house or whatever instead of driving, for instance. What else is another trick of the trade to make sure you exercise?
Do something fun.
Yes, do something fun. You guys are a smart, smart crowd, right? There's 25 ways, 100 ways of exercising. So do something that's fun so you keep doing it. And then somebody, I think, said do something together, or somebody was pointing to a connection. There's a nurse at the hospital, it's a patient of mine, and after her cancer diagnosis, she had 3 friends who had a kind of contract with her. And that was, they would go over to her house, and each of them would drag her out for some type of exercise, whether it was a power walk or going to the gym or, you know, doing something together. So unless she was in a coma, her friends would come over and make sure that she was going to get exercise, right? And, you know, if you do it with a buddy, you say, oh, I'm going to do it for him, and they're, you know, he's like going to do it for me. You know, that type of situation where you're doing it more often. And there's always the kind of social aspect to it. Any other suggestions?
Make it a routine.
Yeah, so it just like, it becomes automatic. So you know, Wednesday morning when I wake up, I'm going to go for my power walk. It just, there's no question. Or Thursday afternoon after work or whatever activity, I know I'm going to go to do the gym or something like that. It's going to be automatic, just so it's part of your routine. Honest to goodness, I could really rant for about 15 minutes on exercise, but we don't have the time. But you know, I could say this. When you remember when you're kind of like 2 minutes into it, like 3 minutes into it, and you say, oh, it feels a little bit, you know, you just don't feel quite right, a little bit nausea, just it's not very fun at that kind of time you break through and get the endorphins going. It's at that moment that you're really sending a message to yourself, to your psyche, to your spirit, about getting better, like healing, getting stronger, wanting to you know, have a really good life. So you're sending that message at that moment. I want to get stronger. I want to get better. And your body will respond. In fact, I think of it from an evolutionary perspective. Because we're the product of tribes, right? We are the successful tribes. We are the progeny of those tribes. If you're a member of the tribe and you were still gathering the berries, or you're the member of the tribe and you were still hunting the animal or whatever it was, then your tribe still needed you. So exercise, when you're doing it, you're releasing these other chemicals into your body that says, I need to live for my tribe. It really is a very, very powerful message to your body. In the same way, you know, when people get depressed and really, you know, really shut themselves down, their life force energy decreases, and it's the one real risk factor of decreasing your longevity, is becoming depressed. And exercise actually helps with depression. Right? So trick your body by exercising, and then your body's getting like, I need to live. My tribe needs me, is what the meta message is from exercising. Okay, so we've got two so far. We got sleep, exercise, and I heard diet. Diet, extremely important as well, right? A profound way to influence your brain. So what are the elements of a good diet? How would you describe a good diet? Yes, good for you, right? Because it is expensive to, you know, buy like the perfect like veggie type of scenario, but the choice is there. We have more options within the society to go on the healthier side, and decrease less of it. So what are the elements again?
Variety,
right? Because you want micronutrients. In fact, almost at every meal as well, to have the micronutrients from multiple sources combined within your body. Color, right. So really it's like veggies, right? What do we need as a supplement here in Canada?
Vitamin D,
10 plus months a year, 1,000 international units. Make sure you're getting your calcium as well. Everybody should be on that. In fact, vitamin D has some anti-proliferative effects, which decreases turnover. Okay, so I want to explain to you in terms of brain function, something called a low glycemic diet, meaning that you don't want your sugars to spike and drop, because I think both those, the spike and the drop, lead to poor brain function. You kind of disengage from your brain. When you don't have enough calories in your system, the high octane part of your brain gets disinhibited, or it gets shut down. So you lose the kind of clear thinking part of your brain, and you start to work out your irritable stress brain, which is actually smart, because when you're hungry, you get irritable and you start looking for food. The hangry feeling, right? So this is the brain part of the brain goes there. And when you have that sugary pop, or the unprocessed white bread, or those type of things, and you get that big spike of glucose and sugar in your system, the body responds by creating insulin and other chemicals to try to get the blood sugar back into your cells. And so then you drop off and you go quite low again. And that's where the brain function really suffers. So the idea is to eat the complex carbohydrate, so it's a slow absorption of the sugar into your bloodstream, so you stay within that kind of very good, kind of the green zone for your blood sugar. And I gave a talk recently with a dietitian, and her point was to really listen to your body in terms of how hungry you are, how much you need to eat, right? So that it's a little bit more often, like eating every 3 hours as opposed to, you know, a little snack here and then a huge supper type thing. You want to kind of keep that blood sugar along the way. Okay, so what do you need to do this? What are some of the tricks? How do you guys make this happen? How do you maximize the chance you eat well?
plan ahead, yeah, for certain. So you're cooking, so you can cook for a few meals?
I treat my wife well.
He treats his wife well. That's fantastic. Yes. Know your strengths and your weaknesses and your allies. Yes. We live in a tribe. Yes. Choose your mates carefully. Yeah. That's good. So one thing I've noticed is if I don't have the sugary, snacky, bad stuff in my cupboard at 10:30 at night, I don't eat it at 10:30 at night. And how do I do that? I try not to go grocery shopping when I'm hungry. Yeah. Right? Because when I'm hungry, I'm going down the aisle, yeah, that looks good, you know, I'm pushing it in type thing. So not having it there, and if you do have the not so healthy stuff, put it in an inconvenient cupboard out of sight. We are so human, this part of the brain can dominate so quickly. If you have the kind of candies in the candy jar, the glass candy jar, and you see them, you're like doing this without even thinking. So you put the candy jar in the drawer, the chocolates in the drawer, so you can't see it, and it maximizes the chance you don't snack unnecessarily. And one more quick one is, you know how you go to a restaurant and then you kind of get the veggies, the kind of starch and your protein? Someone said, eat your veggies first, because if you fill up and don't want to finish it, then you at least have the veggies into your system. Okay, so number three was good diet. Do you have a fourth habit that you can do that can profoundly influence your brain function, your frontal lobe?
Meditation.
Yes.
Eat with somebody as well.
Yes, eat with somebody. Yep. Make it social. Yep.
If I'm alone, I tend to, or my wife's gone, I tend to take things out of the cupboard.
Yeah.
I don't need.
Yeah, agreed. So then you're setting up that pattern of eating slowly, enjoying your company, enjoying your food. I'd also say if you are going to have the piece of cheesecake, you know, make it, you don't have to kind of isolate yourself from, you know, every food that isn't great, really enjoy it. Really slowly savor it. There's no guilt to be had in that situation. It's so much better to really love that feeling slow and sure. And you're much less likely to eat the whole cheesecake if you do that, right? And less guilt actually leads to better, better behaviors in the future. So then there's a whole kind of psychology and neurology around that as well. But I said, I was going on to the fourth one, which someone said meditation, and that was exactly it. So practicing a relaxation technique actually enervates this part of the frontal lobe. And that part of the frontal lobe, actually the balance between the left side and the left side is actually the more positive emotions, the right side the more negative emotion. So you actually change the balance, you're actually a little bit more positive. You'll notice that the frontal lobe overlies the irritable stress brain. And this is what they call dampens down those feelings. So you get emotional regulation. So instead of snapping, being upset and flustered, you're much more likely to be able to stay centered and not buy into those feelings. And the last thing is you're better able to actually pay attention to what's actually happening. Your meditation, relaxation technique brings you back into that ability. So you strengthen that part of your thinking. So really, really good science around that, and it actually improves brain function. You're happier, you have better quality of life, you're more compassionate. It's really, practicing relaxation is very, very powerful. And I want to demystify kind of meditation, just describe what my experience has been for the last 20 years. How many people meditate or do relaxation kind of routinely? So maybe 10%, okay. So I go downstairs, for the last 20 years, most days, I go downstairs the 15 minutes before, you know, I'd have to otherwise. So I get up 15 minutes early, I sit on some pillows, I bring my attention to my breath. So the focus is on my breath. I'm trying to focus my attention on my breath. And within about 3 seconds of starting, I'm starting to think about what I need to do today. Are the WM guys going to appreciate this? You know, what's the group like? I better do some quick reading on what WM so I make sure that I know what I'm talking about. You know, so I'm starting to plan and think about what's happening. And at some point in time, I recognize, I'm not really focusing on my breathing. So I bring my attention back to my breath. And within about 3 seconds of that, I'm starting to think about what happened yesterday. I'm submitting this grant application, and is my boss going to sign this? And oh, if he doesn't sign that, I'm going to have to do that. And at some point in time, I recognize that, again, I'm not paying attention, I bring my attention back. And then I'm off again. And it's like a couple dozen times. Like, this is 20 years later. This is like 20 years of progress. Honest to goodness, this is it. Now, luckily, most days, I do get that, dropping down feeling. I get the relaxation response. There is some improvement. Like, the neurocircuitry is getting stronger as the years go by. What I can say is the days that I practice meditation, and I use the word practice, right? It's a good word, practice. When the days I practice meditation, I feel more centered, more calm. I think I'm more efficient because I'm actually doing one thing at a time. I feel more caring, compassion. I can, you know, look at that person in the eyes and feel that kind of sense of connection with that person. So I really think I'm a better physician on the days when I practice that. And I recognized that as the years went by, I was actually practicing meditation throughout the day. So I'd be like talking with somebody, and then I'd be thinking about what I have to do after work. And I recognize I'm actually not even thinking, not even paying attention to that person. So I come back into the conversation again. So that muscle of bringing your attention back to the here and now is a very, very powerful muscle. Right? So meditation, I really kind of recommend it. In fact, why don't we stand up for a second again? You can get your exercise all in this one hour. So we're going to do a little bit Qigong, because it doesn't all have to be kind of sitting meditation and, you know, the breath and, you know, very still and, you know, levitating and, you know, all that stuff. It can actually just be a little bit of movement. So the idea is to be very curious about what's happening within your body. And I want you to, and I'm just going to probably just yell this now. I want you to imagine that you're standing in a beautiful vat of warm water, beautiful warm water. And so all the movements that we're about to do right now is done with great kind of softness and smoothness. And I also want you to really pay attention to the sensations in your body and or your breath, one of the two. So you're bringing your attention back to the present. So breathing in and breathing out. Nice. And just stay in time then. Breathing in through your nose and out through your mouth. And again, breathing in. Breathing in. And breathing out. Great. Do you feel a sense of relaxation even with that? Is that kind of more peaceful? Yeah, good. You can have a sit then, thanks. So, am I due up at 2:30? Is that my timing? You guys good with that?
Yeah.
Okay, good. I'll cram in the whatever, about 2 hours talking. That's 8 minutes. At our website, I'm going to show you our website. You can see all these talks, and there's lots of free videos where you can practice the relaxation techniques and, you know, learn about these different techniques that I'm talking about. So healingandcancer.org. So it's there for you. So far, I've really pointed to this idea that our bodies influence our brain, and our brains can be function better, and your immune system can function better when you're more in that kind of calmer state, when you're using your wise and compassionate brain. If I look to the mind part of this, we think about stress and the stress reaction, right? Because thinking about the future naturally brings some kind of anxiety or worries. And the idea is, by practicing mindfulness and recognizing when you're feeling stressed and flustered, you can actually change your physiology. So I want to just have you think about the last time that you were feeling really stressed, upset, flustered, angry, upset. Just really, you kind of lost it in that moment. Just in a situation. Could be in the last week, last year. Could be medical, could be otherwise. So bring yourself back to that space. Imagine that you're living in the middle of it. And at the height of when you're feeling the greatest stress, press the pause button. Just press the pause button on that situation. And I want you to scan your physical body. What are the physical sensations that you are noticing when you're feeling your greatest stress right now? So you guys tell me the symptoms, the physical changes in your body of stress.
Heart rate's up.
Yeah, so you're pounding heart rate. What else? Yes, clenched jaw, sweating.
Muscle
tension. There's tension or jitters.
Headache is coming on.
Headache coming on, yeah, nauseated, nasty stomach. What happens to the breath? Could be short breath, could be stuck breath, could be feeling like you have to go to the bathroom. So there's a lot of physical symptoms. And what I'm trying to teach you right now is to recognize your own stress signature. What are the symptoms that you notice? And could be as much as, oh, my gut doesn't feel quite right. In that moment, how would you describe your emotions? What's the emotional content?
Anger.
Yeah, so anger is like seeing red when I put my fist through the computer screen. Yeah. What else? How else would you describe yourself emotionally?
Could be fear.
Could be just fear, anxiety, frustration. Yeah, or it could be sadness, like feeling I'm going to cry. Could be dissociation, like you're complete numbing down, completely separated from your emotions. How does your thinking change?
It's not clear.
Yeah, not clear. So fuzzy or very narrow, or sometimes it cycles very fast on the same thing. What's the content of the thinking? What are the words or sentences that come out? And you don't have to share that within the crowd right now. You're negative. Or correctly spelled, maybe, yeah. So when I'm swearing in my mind, I know that I'm stressed, for instance. Or if I'm labeling, pointing at the world and saying that is bad or that person's bad, or I'm labeling myself, I'm such an idiot. Imagine that there was a magical computer program that could type out all your thoughts for 24 hours. Yeah, so... the blackmail material, right? And then you go back and you read your transcript. How would you know from what the words and sentences were that you were actually having a stress reaction? Right? So it's the same question, right? So something, you know, there are certain cues, and especially the same negative thought comes up. Okay, so I say all that so that you will start to recognize your stress reaction earlier and be able to settle it down faster. And okay, so you can sit in the spot right now. I want you to put your hands in your lower abdomen. And I'm going to take you through this. So you're in that stressful situation. What you can do almost always is press the pause button because you don't need to react right away, almost always. And I want you to become very curious right now. What does it feel like to be in your body? So immediately you're going into your insula, temporal lobe. I want you to take 4 slow breaths into your abdomen. And be very curious. So you're bringing yourself back to the physicality. And then after those slow breaths, I want you to reassure yourself, I can get through this. I'll take this a step at a time. I have the strength and insight to be able to deal with this in a positive way. Right? Okay, good. You look up again, you relax. So just because this is an important technique, if you can recognize that you're feeling stressed, the earlier you recognize, I'm starting to fluster, pressing the pause button to settle yourself down before you decide how you want to respond. And you, what's driving it again is the kind of catastrophization, right? All these bad things are going to happen. Is it, you want to let go of that? You can use the ego and the knowledge later to make a decision, but for now, we're going to let go of that. And become very curious of the physicality. Slow, smooth out-breath is actually taps you into the relaxation part of your nervous system. And then it sends a message up to your brain to say, I'm safe. And then you use the wise and compassionate part of your brain. So you've done the breathing, you're coming back to the sense of compassion, sense of wisdom, and then you reassure yourself with that kind of wise voice that's been encouraging yourself all along. So that's the sudden stresses. Practicing a relaxation technique taps into a whole well of relaxation so you do that more easily. seeing stress as something that is enhancing to your health and your vitality changes the chemistry within your brain. So that's a whole talk itself. So instead of saying, this is bad, I'm stressed, my life is toxic, this is too much, actually say, okay, I see this, you know, something important is at stake here, and I can use the energy of the stress reaction to help me respond. So that simple change in attitude changes how your brain works and how you respond and how you learn from a stressful situation. And the fourth level of stress teaching is actually to work with the thoughts that are causing the stress reaction, with your core beliefs. Right? Because we create a virtual reality for ourselves, essentially. And so those thoughts are causing us to feel worse. And the most obvious example of this is people who are depressed often have some type of core belief that they're useless or, you know, awful or something is wrong with them. Right? So they think that and it leads to depression. And if they could reframe that we all have intrinsic beauty and strength, they would feel better. Because that's actually the truth as well. So that's just tapping you a little bit into the level of the mind. Really, body and mind is all interconnected. So it's all one system. And lastly, I just want to point to the level of spirit. And that is, you know, for instance, when I'm meditating, so in my meditation practice, I'm downstairs, I'm watching, I have the body that's there, the breath is there, I can see the emotional energy, and the emotional energy is like up and down, like some days I feel great, some days I'm stressed and flustered and feeling crappy, and so that's just a natural flow of life, and you know, more and more I can see that the thoughts are coming, but I'm not any of those, kind of like my consciousness, which has been observing this life form for all those years, is different from the body, the breathing, the emotions, the thoughts. But there's something else that is holding my experience. And that observer consciousness or that awareness is the spiritual, points to the spiritual realm. And that realm is very, very peaceful, very calm. And a person can be suffering emotionally, like feeling down, sad, or flustered, and yet have this sense of calm and great peace within their lives. And the analogy is walking along the beach during a hurricane, right? So when you're first diagnosed with WM, it's like, whoa, like you're walking along the beach and the waves are crashing, the winds and salts in your face, and you're getting drenched and you're soaked to your bone and you're flustered and the waves can pull you away and so on. And that's the psychological level of fluster. In the meantime, that same hurricane can be viewed from 3 miles above as a beautiful swirl of clouds, or from 40 feet underneath the water. You know, when you know the waves are crashing up top, there's this kind of sense of peace within the deep ocean. And I've seen a lot of people being able to do that, to be able to have the authentic emotional feelings while being able to tap into something that's bigger than themselves. So that kind of points the idea of spirit there. Okay, so you guys get to decide, the organizers get to decide. I can read like a 3-minute story that's fun and points to something, or we can just have questions or both. What do you say, Gil? Okay? All right. I'd like to thank you very much. I'd like to read you the story of my grandmother because it's talking a little bit about the level of spirit. She was an amazing woman, too. On the eve of my grandmother's 110th birthday, I got a call from her nursing home that she was having chest pain. I was worried she was having a heart attack and wouldn't make it to the big celebration that was being organized for the next day. That would be a shame, because my grandmother was an amazing woman in many ways. She lived in her own apartment till 107, composed poetry up until her final months, and was an exceptional conversationalist with her many visitors. At 109, she pledged to herself that if she made 110, she'd dance on the tables. Now, her health did go down that year, so she's mostly bed down up to the wheelchair type thing. But there she was on the eve of her birthday. I rushed over to the manor to see how sick she was. When I got to her floor, I could hear the sounds of a lively violin coming from her room. Three of her great-grandchildren, who were all excellent musicians, were serenading her with songs both lively and poignant. Forgetting about the symptom of chest pains, which had brought me there, I sat back and listened. The lyrics of one soft song started with, "The birds have flown away." Listening to the beautiful harmony of their young voices, I began to quietly cry, realizing this would be one of the last memories I'd have of this extraordinary woman. Grandma lay in her bed with a smile as broad as her face. As a doctor, I could tell that her body was very weak and she would not live many more weeks. But there she was, looking so happy, at peace, and absorbing every moment to the fullest. And more than that, there seemed to be a glow emanating from her that lit the room with warmth and joy. I've experienced that same feeling at the bedside of many patients who've released themselves into something so deep and mysterious that their inner light was obvious to everyone. Whenever this has happened, I've walked away from a simple conversation lighter on my feet and with the feeling that my heart had been stretched open. My grandmother reminded me that a deep connection to spirit is possible even as the body is fading away and turning to dust. Over my years as a doctor, I've seen many of my patients who are able to let go into the realm of spirit, no longer identifying so closely with their bodies or even their personalities. Something like a pain crisis might dim their light, but once the pain was under control, they could settle their minds and the brilliant light of their spirit could shine through again. I remember a young mother I treated during her initial breast cancer diagnosis and again after it recurred. She had such exuberance for life regardless of her physical health. We had to delay her initial radiotherapy session because she had torn open the mastectomy sutures during a snowball fight with her kids. She was spunky. Years later, when she was in the terminal phase of her life, I saw her again when she needed radiotherapy. Walking into her room, I could see that her body was frail, her skin yellow from cancer in her liver, but her face glowed and her eyes were filled with deep love. Though too weak to get up to greet me, she extended her arms out for a hug. Her voice rang out, "Dr. Rutledge, I'm so happy to see you," as I leaned over for a long embrace. She held not a hint of bitterness about her situation, and I walked away from the clinic that afternoon with a lightness in my heart and an aspiration to share my love with others. When we slow down and are mindful of the true beauty of life, we can become aware of the realm of spirit. It's here all the time, yet so obvious we can overlook it. I'm truly grateful to my grandmother and so many of my patients who have lit the way, showing me the light of their living spirit even as their bodies are fading away. P.S. As it turns out, my grandmother's chest pain resolved that night, and at the party the next day, she conspired with two large men to place her wheelchair up onto a large wooden table. She had everyone in attendance sing songs to her like, "I'm tired and I wanna go home." And all her times, her legs kicked and jigged in rhythm on the table. I think that's it. We're gonna go to questions and time. You guys can cut it off. There's my grandma with her great granddaughter. Good British stock. We have the book on sale. It's the teachings from an entire weekend retreat. I only kind of touched on the mind and spirit there. And it's stories from people who attend the weekend. And then please, if you have questions or want to chat, quite happy to connect. Healingandcancer.org is the name of the website. You know, it's all lots of free stuff there. So we have time for some questions. Yeah. Okay.
Any questions for Dr. Rutledge? This one?
I saw this program on there where somebody press two fingers between your eyebrows is supposed to calm down.
Mm. Yeah, so there's something called EFT, Emotional Freedom Technique, and yeah. You know, they do different stuff like that.
Yeah.
So there's lots of different techniques to actually reset the nervous system to more calm state. And what I'd say, if you want to explore kind of beyond the medical system and beyond, I've kept it very kind of physical here, is to use both your rational mind, like your logic, your science, does this make sense? Is there proof around it? But also trust your intuition. Like, does this feel right for me? Should I explore this opportunity? And when you trust your intuition, you're actually trusting your gut, which is actually connected to your brain anyway. So it's like one system of intelligence. Yeah.
Rob, I'm a Reiki practitioner,
yeah.
and I've been able to give a technique to a lot of people that seems to have helped with insomnia. And it's maybe a bit of a variation on that. Is if you take your dominant hand, if you're right-handed, that's your right hand, when you can't get sleep, stay in bed, stay in the dark, on the forehead, the other hand on your navel,
yeah.
And really what happens is the dominant hand drains the energy from the monkey mind and down into the center.
Nice.
And as often as not, including for my six-year-old granddaughter, within 5 minutes they're asleep.
Nice, so. That's wonderful.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you learn these techniques and you try them and see if they work for you, and just integrate those that work in your life. So having a kind of smorgasbord, it was an absolutely lovely connection. I really appreciated the audience and how quick you guys and how smart you guys were to do that. So really appreciate it. Do me a favor though, buy a book. There's also the DVD, which is, we did a little bit of Qigong. There's some meditation, there's some yoga. So three tracks and a DVD. $20 per book, cash, check, or even if you want to do credit card, you'll just leave your email address and phone number and we'll email you, ask you to pay it on PayPal. So we have it at the back of the room. So huge thanks to Team Wally. Wonderful. Thank you.